Origin of Monmatia, the Urantia solar system. 5 billion years ago, your sun was a comparatively isolated blazing orb, having gathered to itself most of the nearby circling matter of space, remnants of the recent upheaval which attended its own birth. Today, your sun has achieved relative stability, but its 11.5-year sunspot cycles betray that it was a variable star in its youth. In the early days of your sun, the continued contraction and consequent gradual increase of temperature initiated tremendous convulsions on its surface. These titanic heaves required 3.5 days to complete a cycle of varying brightness. This variable star, this periodic pulsation, rendered your sun highly responsive to certain outside influences which would be shortly encountered. Thus, the stage of local space set for the unique origin of Monmatia, that being the name of your sun's planetary family, the solar system to which your world belongs. Less than 1% of the planetary systems of Overton had a similar origin. 4.5 billion years ago, the enormous Angona system began its approach to the neighborhood of his solitary sun. The center of this great system was a dark giant of space, solid, highly charged, and possessing tremendous gravity pull. As Angona more closely approached the sun at moments of maximum expansion during solar pulsations, streams of gaseous material were shot out into space as gigantic solar tongues. At first, these flaming gas tongues would invariably fall back into the sun, but as Angona drew nearer and nearer, the gravity pull of the gigantic visitor became so great that these tongues of gas would break off at certain points, the roots falling back into the sun while the outer sections would become detached to form independent bodies of matter, solar meteorites, which immediately started to revolve about the sun in elliptical orbits of their own. As the Angona system drew near, the solar extrusions grew larger and larger. More and more matter was drawn from the sun to become independent circulating bodies in the surrounding space. This situation developed for about 500,000 years until the Angona made its closest approach to the sun, whereupon the sun, in conjunction with one of its periodic internal convulsions, experienced a partial disruption. From opposite sides and simultaneously, enormous volumes of matter were disgorged. From the Angona side, there was drawn out a vast column of solar gases, rather pointed at both ends and markedly bulging at the center, which became permanently detached from the immediate gravity control of the sun. This great column of solar gases, which was thus separated from the sun, subsequently evolved into the 12 planets of the solar system. The repercussional ejection of gas from the opposite side of the sun in tidal sympathy with the extrusion of this gigantic solar system ancestor has since condensed into the meteors and space dusts of the solar system, although much, very much of this matter was subsequently recaptured by solar gravity as the Angona system receded into remote space. Although Angona succeeded in drawing away the ancestral material of the solar system planets and the enormous volume of matter now circulating about the sun as asteroids and meteors, it did not secure for itself any of this solar matter. The visiting system did not come quite close enough to actually steal any of the sun's substance, but it did swing sufficiently close to draw off into the intervening space all of the material comprising the present-day solar system. The five inner and five outer planets soon formed in miniature from the cooling and condensing nucleuses in the less massive and tapering ends of the gigantic gravity bolts which Angona had succeeded in detaching from the sun, while Saturn and Jupiter were formed from the more massive and bulging central portions. The gravity pull of Jupiter and Saturn early captured most of the material stolen from Angona, as the retrograde motion of certain of their satellites bears witness. Jupiter and Saturn, being derived from the very center of the enormous column of superheated solar gases, contained so much highly heated sun material that they shone with a brilliant light and emitted enormous volumes of heat. They were in reality secondary suns for a short period after their formation as separate space bodies. These two largest of the solar system planets have remained largely gaseous to this day, not even yet having cooled off to the point of complete condensation or solidification. The gas contraction nucleuses of the other 10 planets soon reached a stage of solidification and so began to draw to themselves increasing quantities of the meteoritic matter circling in nearby space. The worlds of the solar system thus had a double origin. Nucleuses of gas condensation later on augmented by the capture of enormous quantities of meteors. Indeed, they still continue to capture meteors, but in greatly lessened numbers. The planets do not swing around the sun in the equatorial plane of their solar mother, which they would do if they had been drawn off by solar revolution. Rather, they travel in the plane of the angulosolar extrusion, which existed at a considerable angle to the plane of the sun's equator. While Angona was unable to capture any of the solar mass, your sun did add to its metamorphosing planetary family some of the circulating space material of the visiting system. Due to the intense gravity field of Angona, its tributary planetary family pursued orbits of considerable distance from the dark giants. And shortly after the extrusion of the solar system ancestral mass, and while Angona was yet in the vicinity of the sun, three of the major planets of the Angona system swung so near to the massive solar system ancestor that its gravitational pull, augmented by that of the sun, was sufficient to overbalance the gravity grasp of Angona and to permanently detach these three tributaries of the celestial wanderer. All of these solar system material derived from the sun was originally endowed with a homogeneous direction of orbital swing, and had it not been for the intrusion of these three foreign space bodies, all solar system material would still maintain the same direction of orbital movement. As it was, the impact of the three Angona tributaries injected new and foreign directional forces into the emerging solar system with the resultant appearance of retrograde motion. Retrograde motion in any astronomic system is always accidental and always appears as a result of the collisional impact of foreign space bodies. Such collisions may not always produce retrograde motion, but no retrograde ever appears except in a system containing masses which have diverse origins. That's from the Urantia book, and now we need to move to the 2020 update, which gives us a little bit more information. In 1934, mankind had yet to discover these three bodies and had yet to name them. So the update identifies which three bodies are talking about. Urantia belongs to a 12-planet solar system known as Monmatia, meaning one dominion. In the North Kielek sector of Nebadon, Overton, Monmatia's sun is a yellow dwarf known as Helios and is orbited by 12 planets consisting of 7 major and 5 dwarfs. Pluto is a stray moon of Neptune, and there are 3 other orphans which in more recent times were named Haumea, Makemake, and Eris, themselves being spherical remnants of the Andronova nebula that became adopted into the gravity circuits of Monmatia. The 12th is also a dwarf named Ceres, which orbits Helios in the asteroid belt between Mars and Jupiter. In comparison to other planets in the solar system of Nebadon, Urantia is a relatively small but extremely fertile world with an ideal life-supporting atmosphere and good landmass geography, which is accessible from its seas, waterways, rivers, and streams. And there, NASA, is how the solar system formed and why Jupiter and Saturn are still gaseous.